77 of your Book of Common Prayer. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
God, you are always more ready to hear than we are to pray, and to give more than we either desire or deserve. Pour upon us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those good things for which we're not worthy to ask, except through the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated.
The first lesson is found on page 2 in the Pew Bibles. A lesson from the book of Genesis, beginning at the 18th verse of the second chapter. Then the Lord God said, "It is not good that the man should be alone. I will make him a helper as his partner." So out of the ground the Lord God formed every animal of the field and every bird of the air, and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. The man gave names to all cattle, and to the birds of the air, and to every animal of the field. But for the man, there was not found a helper as his partner. So the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. Then he took one of his ribs and closed up its place with flesh. And the rib that the Lord God had taken from the man, he made into a woman and brought her to the man. Then the man said, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. This one shall be called woman, for out of man this one was taken. Therefore a man leaves his father and his mother and clings to his wife, and they become one flesh." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The morning psalm is Psalm 8, found in the insert. We will read responsively by whole verse. O Lord, our governor, how exalted is your name in all the world.
Out of the mouths of infants and children, your majesty is praised above the heavens.
You have set up a stronghold against your adversaries to quell the enemy and the avenger.
When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and stars that are set in their courses.
What is man, that you should be so mindful of him? The son of man, that you should seek him out?
You have made him a little lower than the angels. You adorn him with glory and honor.
You give him mastery over the works of your hands. You put all things under his feet.
All sheep and oxen, even the wild beasts of the field.
The birds of the air, the fish of the sea, and whatsoever walks in the paths of the sea.
O Lord, our governor, how exalted is your name in all the world. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The epistle lesson is found on page 170 in the Pew Bibles. A lesson from the letter of Hebrews, beginning at the first verse of the first chapter. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the worlds. He is the reflection of God's glory, and the exact imprint of God's very being. And he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. Having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. Skipping to chapter 2, verse 5. Now God did not subject the coming world, about which we are speaking, to angels, but someone has testified somewhere. What are human beings that you are mindful of them, or mortals that you care for them? You have made them for a little while lower than the angels. You have crowned them with glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet. Now in subjecting all things to them, God left nothing outside their control. As it is, we do not yet see everything in subjection to them, but we do see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, now crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. It was fitting that God, for whom and through whom all things exist, and bringing many children to glory, should make the pioneer of their salvation perfect through sufferings. For the one who sanctifies and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
St. Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Some Pharisees came to test him. They asked Jesus, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? Jesus answered them, what did Moses command you? They said, Moses allowed a man to write a certificate of dismissal and to divorce her. Jesus said to them, because of the hardness of your heart, he wrote this commandment to you. But from the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, a man shall leave his mother and father and be joined to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one. Therefore, what God has joined together, let no one separate. Then in the house, the disciples asked him again about the matter. He said to them, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery. People were bringing little children to him in order that he might touch them. The disciples spoke sternly to them. But when Jesus saw this, he was indignant and said to them, let the little children come to me. Do not stop them, for as such is it those that the kingdom of heaven belongs to. Truly, truly, I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter it. And he took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and he blessed them. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Please be seated. Have you ever been in conversation with someone and they're using a word you just don't understand? Maybe they're mispronouncing it so badly you do know it, but you don't understand it when they're saying it. Maybe it's one of those situations where that word that you keep on saying, I do not think it means what you think it means, to quote the Princess Bride. But sometimes context clues don't help, or maybe they don't give us the full meaning. Just hold on to that for a moment this morning. The Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. I'll make him a helper as his partner. Now in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. We know the words. We affirm it, the creed, that God began everything. And here we find ourselves in the second chapter of Genesis, where we go over again, kind of a replay of creation, with some different emphasis than what we get in the first chapter. Here we find Adam has been made from the dust of the earth and given responsibilities, but he's lonely. And God says that he needs a helper as a partner. Let me ask a question here. And I seriously, this is not rhetorical this morning. I'd like you to give me your input here. When you hear the word helper, what comes to mind? An assistant, right? Somebody this morning said gopher. I know that when my dad, before he was called into the ministry, morning dad, was a pipe fitter. And whenever I would go to help him, this meant that I did what? I carried big heavy pipes from point A to point B. I got to help dig ditches. It was exciting work like that. Did I actually get to engineer things out and put it together? No. Let's talk about this word here. The same word that we use here is the same one that David uses in the Psalms when he talks about how God is going to come and help us and be a helper to us. It's the word Moses uses to describe God when he says God's going to come and help us out of Egypt. Isaiah uses this word too. Sometimes it also seems to have the sense of someone having your back, someone who's not going to leave you when times are tough, someone that you can trust implicitly. And I don't think that David or the other psalmists, I don't think Moses or Isaiah had this idea in their head that God was their assistant. Do you? No. Well, we'll get there in a minute when we read what David says about creation. Genesis goes on to say this. So out of the ground the Lord God formed every animal of the field and every bird of the air and brought them to the man to see what he would call them. Whatever the man called every living creature, that was its name. Here we get this kind of poetic, ideal understanding about what humanity was doing, what Adam was doing here as interacting with creation at the beginning. That God gave us responsibility to name everything and then to take care of it. Genesis goes on to say, the man gave names to all the cattle and the birds of the air and every animal of the field. But for the man, not one was found a helper to be as a partner. And that through it all, our animal companions can be named, they can be loved, they can be with us. They don't fulfill exactly the roles in our lives that other people take. Let me get to it. The Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. And he took one of his ribs and closed it up, its place, with flesh. And of course, we have this very familiar passage that discusses God's creative work in making women. And that leads us to this little bit we're very familiar with, right? Therefore, a man leaves his father and mother and clings to his wife, and they become one flesh. Now let's leave this verse for just a few minutes here in perfection in Eden. We'll get back to it in our gospel. David says this morning, O Lord, our governor, how exalted is your name in all the world. Now David here is reflecting on the beauty of creation, right? When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you set in their courses. That God created everything in the beginning, everything we can see and everything we can't see. But then ask the question, what is man that you should be mindful of him? The son of man that you should seek him out? And here is humanity. And it's a similar question to what Job and his friends discussed at various points. Why should the Creator God pay any attention to us? David's response here is, you've made him but a little lower than the angels, and you adorned him with glory and with honor. God made us with an intention, with a purpose. David says, you gave him mastery over the work of your hands. You put all things under his feet. But under his feet to take care of creation, to be God's helpers with it. And all David can say when he thinks about the beauty of what God made is to repeat, O Lord our Governor, how exalted is your name in all the earth. In our gospel we read, some Pharisees came to test him. They asked, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? Now in Mark's gospel, remember, we're after the feeding of the 5,000, Jesus walking on the water, the feeding of the 4,000, Peter's proclamation that Jesus was the Son of Man, Son of God, the Messiah, and then the rebuke of Peter a little later on. We're past the transfigurations. We're past a lot of the healings. In the last couple weeks, we've heard discussion out about how we need to be like little children. We're told that whoever is for us, it's not really our enemy. And here we get another test, another attempt to get Jesus to say something that could be used against him. What's Jesus' response to all this? He asked them, what does Moses say? And they reply, well, Moses says we can go and get a divorce. All we have to do is the paperwork, and it's done. And Jesus tells them it was done because of the hardness of their hearts. I think what he's trying to get here is, this is because of the brokenness of the world. Because of the sin, the selfishness that lies at the heart of each one of us. We can't always put our needs ahead of those. We should be helping the way God does. We don't always have their backs like the way God has ours. And Jesus reminds them of this. For this reason, a man will leave his wife and mother, or his father and mother, and be joined to his wife, and the two become one flesh, so that the two are no longer two, but one. Everything that God has joined together, let no one separate. When we left in need, it was a different situation, wasn't it? No sin yet. But Jesus is living in the time of the Roman Empire, and the Roman Empire is a little bit like we are, and a lot of times like we care to admit. A lot of upper-class Roman families, and even through the middle, you'll find divorce and remarriage is rampant, but it's rampant to gain status. You'll see these same names being married to senators and Caesars and emperors over and over and over again. And it's not that there were 300 women named Claudia. They were in the upper classes. It was the same Claudia, the same Caesarea, getting married to different men as they ascended. Hey, my husband's on his way down. Time to get rid of you and time to get a better one. The type of marriage that John excoriates, John the Baptist I'm talking about here, when he gets in trouble with Herod Antipater and Herodias, one that's done for political reasons. In that case, between family members. Herodias divorced one brother and married the other. She's the niece of both. That's not what God wanted to his people, although I'm sure to them it felt very Roman, very cosmopolitan. He said to them, whoever divorces his wife and marries another commits adultery against her. And if she divorces her husband and marries another, she commits adultery. When they get alone, the disciples ask again, hey, Jesus, really, is that the teaching? And Jesus reiterates it. Now, we know in the Gospels, Jesus says, listen, if someone's being unfaithful to you, you can divorce. And I think the Bible would also say we shouldn't stay in abusive or neglectful relationships. But I also think Jesus is saying that the sacrament of marriage isn't something that we should enter into lightly. And we get back to something that the disciples have been wrestling with, don't we? People were bringing their little children to him in order that he might touch them. And the disciples spoke sternly to them. Now, I know the disciples here were only trying to manage the crowds. I'm sure it was like at a baseball game. If you ever go to a baseball game, what do fathers do with their little kids when the ball players come near? Push them forward with the pin and the ball and try to get them to sign things, right? Here they just wanted a blessing. The disciples were trying to clear Jesus' path. That's not what Jesus wanted. He says this to the disciples, truly, truly, I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God as a little child will never enter into it. Now, this is the third consecutive week that we've read in Mark's gospel
that Jesus is trying to explain to them. In real terms, this may be a few days or a few weeks since Jesus said it to them the first time. But after saying that, what did Jesus do? He stopped what he was doing and what? Took them up in his arms, laid his hands on them, and blessed all of them. The writer of Hebrews says, long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in various ways by the prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things. Through him, he also created the worlds. Now, Hebrews is a book with a singular purpose. It's to remind Christians that Jesus is superior to everything else in creation. Why? We start here with this. In the past, God had to speak through the prophets. He had to speak through Moses and Elijah, Isaiah and Jeremiah, and all the rest. But now we don't need to hear God through an intermediary. We've heard him through the Son, through the air, the one who helped create the world, the very Word itself. He is a reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being. And he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. And the writer here is saying that he's directly reflecting the glory of God in a way that we can't. That he's the sustainer of everything on this planet. And beyond all that, he came down to earth to live and to die, to be resurrected and ascended, and then sat down at the right hand of the Father. And because of all this, he says this, he's become much superior to the angels, as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs. Jesus is over them. This is why Paul can say, even if we come back, or an angel from heaven comes and tells you to forsake Jesus, don't. Angels are not over everything. The writer goes on to say, now God did not subject the coming world about which we are speaking to angels. But someone has testified somewhere. What are human beings that you're mindful of them, or mortals that you care for them? You made them a little while lower than the angels. You crowned them with glory and honor, subjecting all things under their feet. Another familiar reading this morning. God did not leave, but God left us in charge of the world, for good and for ill. We do not worship the angels, but not because they're not powerful. Don't worship them because Jesus is better. The writer says, but we do see Jesus, who for a little while was made lower than the angels, but is now crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that by the grace of God he might taste death for everyone. Jesus became flesh for a time, the writer says, but he's ascended with glory and honor. And the one who sanctifies, and those who are sanctified all have one Father. For this reason, Jesus is not ashamed to call them brothers and sisters, saying, I will proclaim your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. And God, and Jesus made us, through his work, heirs of God and joint heirs with him. We're called to follow him. That's why we're here today, in person or away. We're called to remember that the Creator God loves us. He loves us so much that we're separated from him. He sent Jesus to come and bridge the gap and bring us into his family. Now today's readings are a bit more focused than many we get. God is calling those who are married to love each other, to recognize who we're called to be, to model Christ's love for each other, one to the other. That we're called to help each other the same way that God takes care of us, to protect each other the way the Lord protects us. All of us are called to follow him like a little child with naive love and know that it is he who we worship, not anything else in creation. Let's take a few moments today and reflect upon the glory of God and the love he shared for us. As you're able this morning, please stand with me. Let's affirm our faith in the Lord tonight and the Creator.
Father the Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen, we believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate in the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Kneeling if you're able this morning. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
We all be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
And your name be glorified by all people.
We pray for Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our presiding bishop, Sean, our presiding bishop-elect, Daniel, our bishop, Jeremiah, our priest, Emmanuel, bishop in Western Tanganyika, and Elias, bishop in Tabora, Tanzania, and all bishops, priests, and deacons.
The church works and sacraments.
We pray for Joe, our president, and Josh, our governor, and for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in your sight.
We pray for compassion on Mark Sarienko, Brandon Newford, Jill Downey, Jane Robbins, Jane Kennedy, Bob Rhodes, Artie Carter, Martha Heffelfinger, Corey Freeman, Donna Milchner, Hazel Pankos, Bishop Sackett, Reverend Dan Olson, Marie Stahl, Phil Donahue, Michael Wigner, Charles Berridge, Bert Blackburn, Anna McFall, Steve Bennett, Carrie Yordi, Scott Conley, Robert Cruz, Robert Emery, Connie Rupert, and Georgette Druckenmiller, and all who suffer from any grief or trouble.
And may they be delivered from their distress.
Giving thanks for the life and memory of the departed members of the Black Rock Fire Company, give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light perpetual shine upon you.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others, silently or aloud.
Pray for all the people impacted by the hurricanes, both the ones that have come and the ones in the forecast. Please keep them safe and remind them that you walk with them no matter what. Amen.
One of the great smithies this morning, that there is a confirming for the state. Take the nine. peace in the Holy Land and throughout the Middle East. Lord, peace in Russia and Ukraine, and peace throughout your world. Heavenly Father, you promise to hear what we ask in the name of your Son. Accept and fulfill our petitions, we pray, not as we ask in our ignorance, or as we deserve in our sinfulness, but as you know and love us through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you, in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have done. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
And as you're able this morning, please stand with me. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Peace. I promise there's no lava here. Peace. Ascribe to the Lord the honor due his name. Bring offerings and come into his courts.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is a right and good and a joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we fall into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took a cup of wine. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, and this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and at the last day brings with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done,
trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
That Christ died for you, and feel him in your heart by faith with thanksgiving.
ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord, to him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, the honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you now and remain with you always.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated for the announcements this morning.
Do we have any birthdays or anniversaries this week?
Yay!
Happy birthday, Barbara. Is that why you're here for a party? No, the rest of us invited. Thank you, I appreciate it. Stay here, I'm going to pray. Let us pray. Oh God, our times are in your hand. Look with favor, we pray, on your servant Barbara as she begins another year. Grant that she may grow in wisdom and grace and strengthen her trust in your goodness all the days of her life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
I want to start this morning. I've had several questions about what the church is doing and how the church can help with the Helene cleanup and the construction work that's going to be going on there for probably the next year, year and a half. What we're going to do when Milton comes barreling through Florida here in the next few days. And we are going to continue to give to Episcopal Relief and Development. They have been on the ground since Helene came through the panhandle and have been there all the way along. So if you give anything to the church that says Helene, or an envelope that says Helene or Hurricane, that will all go there. And I'll have a link up to the donation page on the Facebook as well, so anybody who'd like to give who's far away will do that. If you'll keep in prayer, the Smithies left this morning to go back to Florida. When I talked to Barry yesterday, he said, rather than go straight to the coast just in time for Milton, they were going to spend a couple of more days in the Orlando area because they felt like it would probably be better to be further inland than where they live. And John and Faye Nine are also leaving this week, or are scheduled to go back to Florida for the winter. So keep the Smithies and the Nines, Jerry Berman, and all of our other friends, the Heatons and everyone else, in prayer this week as they prepare. But know that we're going to continue to love and support those who are in need as best we can. Next Saturday already is the second, will be the second Saturday of the month, and we'll have men's breakfast on the 12th at O'Grady's in Phoenixville at 9 a.m. Let Pat Burkholder know if you're able to come. And the Perky Lassies are meeting next Saturday at noon at Cedar Hollow down in Malvern. The hosts are Sherry, Becky, and Pat Baum. So please let one or all of them know that you're able to come by the 7th if you'll be able to be there with them next Saturday. Now next Sunday, our 9:30 service will be at Old Union Church. It'll be our last morning prayer there of the year, but we're looking forward to it. We hope the weather continues as nice as it's been the last few days. And then our next Bring Your Own Lunch, which is just a time for people to come and get to know each other and eat lunch and share snacks, is on Thursday, October the 17th at 11:30 a.m. And then on Friday, Artie Medina will be here to play and sing in a concert. We'll have a love offering available, so please come that night here at the church at 7 p.m. And bring your love and support for Artie when you come. And then we'll have healing prayers on the weekend of October 19th and 20th. All the services there. And then remember that November is not quite around the corner, but we're already part of the way through October. And on Friday, November the 1st, we'll have an All Saints Day service here at noon. And on the 2nd, we'll have an All Souls Day service as part as our regular 5:30 p.m. service on Saturday, November the 2nd. And if you're coming to that service, please bring pictures of your loved ones that are waiting for you in heaven, and give us their names so that we can remember to pray for you and for them that evening. Now, we are still collecting canned good items and toiletry for Project Outreach in Spring City. I thought Boris was going to get his back out this morning with all the items that he carried across in the basket to be blessed. We're still working on that. For October, for the soup kitchen, we've been asked to collect ground coffee, not whole beans or cake cups, but ground coffee, so that their clients can have warm coffee to start their days. And then we're continuing our clothing drive to help St. James in Collegeville. I think there are another, goodness, probably 10 bags on the stage. So thank you all for your faithfulness there. Are there any other prayer requests, are there any other announcements this morning? Fran.
I have an announcement of thank you for everyone who donated or volunteered at the Blood Help virtual thing between all of you here and the remote ones that Shelley invited to donate to get 70 pints of blood, which is amazing.
So for those at home, Fran is just giving a big thank you for all of those who are able to participate either in person or by volunteering to help that day with the blood drive between the people that were here for the collection on the blood drive day and those who gave in Troy Kane's memory across the country. They collected 70 pints of blood that day. And that's a blessing, I know, for the Red Cross and for many. Any other announcements this morning? You'll stand with us as you're able, all right?
Hallelujah.
Thanks be to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.